Okay, thank you. Where's the staff? Chop chop.
Chop chop.
Chop chop chop. I do have a list of questions, but I think a lot of them actually have been asked, but I'm going to pick up on where Councillor Gallagher was going first, because it's peaked in my mind here. So if I, and I know the things, and can I just say at the outset, I think the task force has tried, I think their intentions are really solid here. They do want to not fix the CBD, that's the wrong word, but help with the vibrancy. What if I parked for 2 hours, then I know that I have to move my car once the 2 hours is up to an off street. Because if I parked for 2 hours in one place, Victoria Street, drove down the road, decide I want to go to a cafe and outside arts post, I'm going to possibly get pinged. How do we measure if I park for 2 hours, 5 minutes across the bridge to Hamilton East, 10 minutes later I'm back in town again, in a different location? It's following on from Councillor Gallagher's question. And, you know, I've effectively left the CBD, but I've come back again. I'm going to get a ticket, aren't I? Chances are high that I'm going to get a ticket.
Yep. So I'll ask John to answer that one.
Well, I think you just did.
Okay, what happens is a sensor picks up a car parking in a car park. Now, it may be 10 minutes before a warden walks past, but when they walk past, they actually scan the registration label, which has got a barcode on it. That parking event is then associated with that registration number. That is stored in a database, and we've had a discussion, and we can set whatever time period we want on that. We were saying 24-hour period. If we sort of have it expiring after 4 hours, we can have it expire after 4 hours. But if that car then moves to another space, another event starts to occur, as the warden goes past and scans that one, that registration number is logged against the same, for that second event is logged against the one registration number.
So I understand that. So my point is, if I legitimately leave the CBD, go to Hamilton East for 15 minutes, return legitimately back to the CBD to pick up a new 2 hour free parking, chances are I might get pinged.
You probably will, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Just there. The 15 minutes you're away clearly won't be part of the 2 hours.
Yep.
No. When I've used up my 2 hours, I've legitimately let...
Yeah.
I've used up...
Sorry.
Two scenarios,
yeah.
I've legitimately used my 2 hours, park, go further down the road in the same CBD, park again, could get pinged. Understand that through the messaging. Same scenario, legitimately use my 2 hours, leave the CBD, go to Hamilton East, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes later, come back, I could be pinged.
Correct.
Yeah. There's no ability to know, obviously, no ability to know that I've legitimately left and I'm starting a new free parking term.
Yeah.
And there's no legit... In the proposal, there's no no way to pay.
Yep, yeah, good.
I think, Chris, it was in answer to Councillor Pascoe's question, you said... my question is, it was in response to you said the perceived success about that we would monitor it with knowing how many more cars are in the CBD and more parks and in that, and we would hit that 85%. But isn't the perceived success that we're trying to achieve more spend in the CBD? Okay. So that actually is, and I absolutely get that. If I truly thought that free parking would do it overnight, I would be there. You said, and I'm going to touch on this early, found this last night. You said that there was no evidence, and we're not basing this proposal on evidence other than, I think it was the Hastings, you said, wasn't it?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah. And that theirs is about... an improved sense. There's no evidence to suggest that it worked. I spoke last night to Lower Hutt City Council, and like there's councils all around New Zealand and around the world that have tried some element of free parking. But lucky for us, Lower Hutt actually took some economic data and evidence-based data, and they have concluded through that data and research from Market View, which is an independent external, that there was little change. And in fact, when I spoke to the staff member, so I'm asking you if you're aware of this, but I spoke to the staff member, the general manager, who said that that economic data proved that when the rest of the city, spend goes up, so like say at Christmas time we know the base is booming and whatever, that in actual fact during the free parking period, their sales didn't reach the same level as what they should have anyway. So the conclusion, with a whole lot of other evidence, was that free parking had no significant impact in improving retail spend in their CBD. So how come we haven't seen that? This is the first time I've seen it, and I'm sure the members of the task force would have a different proposal today if we'd had that information. And they've been doing that trial for 15 months. I didn't know about it. I'm not trying to be... Sorry, my question's relevant.
Can I try to? Chris, would you mind if I...
Is he? Oh.
Yeah.
And correct me if I'm wrong. We do indeed have got... I have got information about Hutt Valley. I have information also about...
Well, I didn't get it.
And agree with what you're saying. I don't believe I'm incorrect here, but I think the key is... Hutt Valley, along with Hastings, and also Rotorua, who have also trialled free parking,
yeah.
I don't believe they actually had access to the same level of technology to police the worker shuffle, the workers using retail.
Yeah.
I think that was a key thing.
Yeah.
Nelson has had free parking for 3 years.
Yeah, okay.
And they've got no current... plans to change it.
Yeah.
Not that they're necessarily saying it's a blinding success, but it seems to be working pretty well, was the quote we got. But even Nelson, my understanding is, don't actually have the same level of technology just to try and stop the workers parking in the things.
So I guess my question though was, and it's good that you've acknowledged I didn't attend the first couple of parking meetings, but this is not about, the proposal, as I understand, is not about providing more parking. It's actually about vibrancy to the CBD, and that's not, Jeff, what you just answered my question on at all. This is not evidence about technology, it's evidence about the actual outcome of retail spend, and the report says it didn't work. So I think that it was unfortunate that we didn't have... Well, it is correct.
No, all I was saying was well...
No, go.
I'm just trying to explain, that's all. All I was saying, and I may be wrong, but I don't think I am, was it wasn't working. My understanding was it wasn't working as well there because they lacked the technology to stop workers parking in retail car parks, which affected the spend. That's something, yeah.
So I think what... I understand from the task force is we're the first place in New Zealand
to trial
a system that will genuinely stop people park hopping from shopkeepers from hogging the parks all day on a 2-hour free parking system. That's what came out of the task force very strongly, and no one else in New Zealand is trialling it, a system with technology back to ensure that doesn't happen.
Wonder if I can finish my questions. So that was one of my questions. So we are the only, will be the only city in New Zealand to trial this technology. So it is untested.
Correct.
And so what about...
In a New Zealand context, yeah.
Yeah. So, and I'm absolutely supportive of better technology, 100%. But so and I missed this part of the meeting, but has it been trialled overseas? Has it been trialled anywhere, or is it like innovative new technology?
Parts of the technology are tried and tested, like the data collection, the domes. So in actual fact, the base make good use of the domes, and that technology's proven. So it's just the combination of the technology has probably never been used, and the strategy around that has not been adopted.
So with the other free parking situations that have happened in New Zealand or elsewhere, have they had an element of paid parking, or have they also taken that off the table, which is what we're doing?
Sorry, when you say an element of paid parking?
So a couple of the other free parking trials that I've been aware of, and ones that we've done in the past, there's always been, once it's over, you pay. And this proposal is not doing that.
I'm not sure of the answer to that in the other areas. So your issue is after 2 hours that you could pay for the extra 1 hour?
Yeah. So I guess the answer is you're not aware of any other parking proposal that's been trialled with an element of free parking that then, when that free parking proposal element is over, it goes to paid parking. This is fundamentally different from anything that I've seen.
I'll just confer with Jason a bit.
Yes or no?
We're just looking. I'm not sure just offhand.
That's an answer as well if you're not sure. So the targeted rate doesn't apply to CBD residents, does it? It's just it's catched to the bid district.
That's my understanding. Yes.
Yeah. Mm. But it doesn't allow, not that there's a lot, but it doesn't allow for those businesses that already pay for their own private parking.
Do you have something to say?
Yeah, maybe I can just clarify around the targeted rate. So there's two elements to the targeted rate. Both mm-hmm. HCC Hamilton is a targeted rate in itself, as is the fixed charge. So the fixed charge specifically for CBD commercial property, the HCC Hamilton applies to all rateable properties, which also includes CBD commercial property and all other property.
I think that was clear in the report. So there's the CBD businesses will actually pay twice through the HCC Hamilton, which is, and through this targeted rate.
That's right.
Okay, answered that one. Just a minute, I just got to get more. Have we thought about, and you would know more about car park buildings than anyone else, Chris, probably around the table, what is the impact of the proposal, either if it's successful or not, in terms of people parking on the street? Then, the best scenario would be somebody parks on the street, then decides they want to stay in town and go to the movies or whatever, they understand the message and then they go into a car park building. So what, do we have the capacity there to cope with that shift in the car park buildings? Because I know we don't own them all anymore.
Look, I don't know the answer to that, but I expect that we will see an increase in off-street car parking if we're taking away options for workers. They're either going to have to jump on a bus or a bike or go into peripheral CBD parking and walk, or go into the car parking buildings, which are geared up for sort of early bird parking and the commuter market. The parking strategies we've adopted over time is really that the market will respond at a point in time when we need more off-street car parking. So at the moment, there is quite a lot of off-street car parking, more so than in 2010 when we adopted the strategy, because we're getting a lot of buildings that are just turned into car parks at the moment, and it's forever changing. Mm.
Okay. Hang on. Answered all of those ones. So just to be with the zones, in relation to the zones that are proposed, the same applies. I park for 2 hours in whichever zone. I either leave the CBD or I move my car into a car park building. So I can't park for 2 hours in one zone and 2 hours in another zone.
So the proposal in front of you would do away with the two zones? So it would merge the blue zone and the yellow zone into parking zone?
I thought there was a map still.
Yep, so the map was just to remind councillors of the current parking CCTP strategy.
Okay.
But this proposal just merges them into one parking zone.
All right. Just on the technology, in the current technology that we deferred, because we wanted this work to come forward, that is quite significantly different, isn't it, to what this parking proposal has in terms of technology?
So the parking sensors is common to both proposals, but the previous one had pay kiosks. So this proposal would not have a need for pay kiosks because you don't have to pay for parking, it's free. So that's the difference. And I was just going to add the opportunity then comes to spend more on the information sensors. So it gives us the ability to cover the whole combined zone now with the sensors, because previously we're only putting sensors in the blue zone and concentrating on the blue zone.
Yeah.
So if we shifted to this proposal, we'd have the ability within the funding proposed to put the sensors across the whole CBD.
So one of the things that this proposal will give us that we haven't had before is information on that, because those two zones, blue and yellow, whatever, we're only getting 30% use of that northern end. So this proposal will give us all the measurements and all the data
of the
entire area.
The existing CCT proposal will give us the domes for the blue zone, and the current proposal in front of you would give us the sensors across the whole zone.
Yeah. Just on the current proposal that's there, I note that there is supposed to be an action that we have reports back on the revenue, on the parking revenue and parking use. I think it was twice yearly, and we haven't had that, but I'm assuming you're collecting that information?
I think at the time of doing this, we had anticipated to roll out the parking technology a few months ago, and it's been put on hold while we had the election and we're having this debate now. So we wanted to match the technology to the parking plan adopted by council, and it's the technology that gives us the real information to provide to council.
Okay, thanks. Just a question to the CE or Matthew, maybe. I note in the annual plan report with the consultation document, if the proposal goes ahead, that you've put in copies of the revenue and financing policy and some other financial policies. I'm just a little concerned that about the weight that those policies possibly should have when we're making decisions, because the policies are just simply locked into the documentation for change, and yet they are key policies that are required by legislation. Is that best practice to have? It would feel like to me that if we were looking at a significant revenue and financing policy and changing it, that we would actually have a proper review in the wider context, because that talks about how we fund things, and I'm a little bit concerned about simply having them in a document as a result of a proposal about how we fund something.
Yep, so I think you sort of answered your own question a little bit. Firstly, you're correct that there's usually a process we follow for the revenue and financing policy, and I think I mentioned that last Thursday. We take the revenue and financing policy through the 10-year plan process, and we consider for each of our activities how we choose to fund it.
Hmm.
There's nothing wrong, though, with extracting out of it, as long as it's not changing our fundamentally impacting on other activities, to pull out a specific activity and actually consider the funding of that activity.
Okay.
So we are able to do that. And the fact that this is specifically doing it through the targeted rate, through Access Hamilton, and through the for the bid aspect of it, and ultimately it is focused, so it's not overflowing to other areas. If it was, maybe there'd be some concern. But then if we change our general rate percentage, for example, we don't have to go through consultation. It's just the annual plan process as well, so that's not an issue either.
Yeah.
But the process we're going to follow for the rest of everything else is through the 10-year plan process.
Yeah, that makes me uncomfortable for the rest of everything else. But, I mean, a key principle of that policy is that we've set a principle that says that user charges, where we can will be the preferred way of funding something when we can provide a direct benefit link. And there's nothing more direct than I hate parking meters as well, but parking a car and putting your money in because you're using the car park. But anyway.
We're actually required as part of the revenue and financing policy to consider all... We've got to go through a process, so you consider all of your funding needs in terms of what you need to fund, and then consider what the best mechanism. It wouldn't be a completely good practice to just assume
that there was a
the user pays in all cases, because the Section 101.3A... B, sorry, it's been a long time since I've been the CFO here, so I was only one letter off, requires council to go through a proper process in terms of assessing the payment of it, but then council can vary that and has the authority to do so as well.
Yeah, I know that. Yeah, okay. Yep. All right. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Councillor Phillip.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. I think a couple of questions already been answered. I just want to follow on with the question from Councillor Larry. I noticed the word cumulative total, right? So in the recommendation, 2 hours will be cumulative total, right? Between the hour 8 o'clock in the morning until 8 p.m. Does it mean I can shift my car 3 or 4 times as long as within that 2 hours?
Correct.
But that needs the technology to monitor plus the parking water to take a photo of the license, right?
Correct.
There might be some variation. Maybe you have 2.5 hours, you never know. But the chance is the whoever parked it. So you can park 3 or 4 different parking spots.
Correct.
Okay, that's one good. Further to the question from Councillor Pesco about the rates for the percentage and all those. And I think it mentioned about why not we have a fixed target rate, like per household, rather than fix it into like variation between the valuation of your property. Is the task force group not consider having a fixed rate? Because the reason why I asked that, I did calculate for the amount 1.667 million for 90% divided by 56,385 households in Hamilton is roughly about the same amount, $26, and then $20 for the first year. So would that be easier to just charge the whole same rate for all households instead of the evaluation up and down?
So can I just jump in there? Yep. This is a consultation document, so it's going out for consultation, and it'll be feedback around these types of issues, which then we'll come back discuss. Okay. And we're in a position then to, depending on the feedback that comes back, to alter the method that we collect the money depending on the feedback. And what we feel is appropriate. So
that's the other question. Actually, we're not into the proposal yet, the consultation paper, right? We're not into that yet. But just, I just think this needs to be a question within the paper, asking the resident they prefer to have a fixed target rate or a variation rate. I think this is the important information we need to get from the residents. And further to that, on the other hand, for this business in the CBD, I did the calculation again. So it's all the amount divided by 1,201 retails. That's the amount 139. So you're not considering about ANZ Bank, they pay more than someone just selling cupcakes. Would you consider the variation that, or just everybody pay the same? So that's a fixed target rate while the resident paying floating rate or variation. So would that be?
Yep, so everybody pays the same.
Yep. Yeah, I did calculate $139.05. That's the same. So that's the way how you calculate all the business. So ANZ Bank pay the same as the cupcake shop.
Yeah, it's the same for every SUI.
Yeah, it is. So as part of the local government, council is required to specify how they will set targeted rates, and the options are by rating assessment, so effectively the single property, or by separately used or inhabited part of a rates assessment, which is what this proposal is about, and that's also the same as how the Hamilton Gardens and the bid rates are set. So ultimately, each council has a policy or a definition of what is a separately used or inhabited part of a rating unit. So in those examples, each of those would fit as a single part.
So it's the same, they pay the same?
It is, yep.
But for the residential, we are asking for variation. So that might be a good question to be going into the consultation paper.
Yeah, certainly. So that's the distinction between the targeted rate, the fixed charge, and the remainder of the rate set on it, the capital value.
Okay. And also about the on the table on 47, I know it said the pins is for parking infringement, right? And the tins, is it for warrant of fitness and registration.
Yeah, T for traffic infringement.
Oh, okay, so pins and pins.
T is traffic,
okay.
So that's warrants and it is explained somewhere.
Now, I noticed it seems the assumption is if we're going to go ahead with this option, the parking three for 2 hours, this both will go down, right? But is that the assumption that this might increase? Because if we have more cars parking here, we should increase our infringement tickets or revenue on that. Is that
no,
right?
A lot of our infringement is about overstaying the time. But this is free parking for 2 hours now. So when you look at it that way, we suspect that there'd be a lot of... And the data we've got, people generally want to be here for 80 minutes. So the 2 hours is a generous time to be here. So we think it would be unlikely that people will be overstaying and we wouldn't be...
Yep. Okay, the last question is, I know the first 9 months is 0.7% raise increase, right? But I think there's something seriously wrong on the consultation paper. 0.7% in year one and 0.2% in year two. So it should be 0.9% in year two, right?
Can you just point out the page?
That's page six on the consultation document there. So I was trying to work out 0.2% is only $6. Yeah, supplementary, yeah. 0.2% is only $6.
If I can, so that's talking about the rates increase?
That should be 0.9, is it?
No, it shouldn't. Can I? So, Philip, the rate increase, the rates increase in the first year is 0.7%. And then the rates increase the following year is a further 0.2%.
So I think it needs to be very clear, because 0.2% in year two, that might be mistaken about second year only 0.2%. Why not make it 0.9%?
So you look at the figures below that are the 3.8%. So it's a 3.8% increase each year as the base. We don't say 3.8% and then 7.2% and then 11 point whatever percent. It's about the increase for that year is what that graph shows. That's how we have shown rate increases in all of our previous documents.
Yeah, but 0.7 year one, 0.2 year two, to me it seems like it doesn't make sense that way. But anyway, if that's the way how English has been constructed, I don't know. But anyway, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Philip. Councillor Siggy.
Chair. Yes, I understand we put this out to we'll see whether we put it out to consultation to the public. But the main objective is first of all to bring the city into more vibrancy. Hopefully, they spend more money, people spend more money, and so on. But also stop the workers from parking long term in the city. Now, and I do read that there will be an encouragement for more biking, public transport and ride sharing. But I think that needs to be noted for people as well, that needs to go into the consultation paper, that we do encourage them to, we need to give them because now that they can't park, even if they do it dodgily in town, give them an answer to, look, we're gonna improve the bus system, or we do certain things if you come by bike or whatever. You know, there has to be a bit more. I mean, I haven't seen many. When I used to bike into town years ago, there were lots of bike stands. I haven't seen many bike stands around town anymore, and it isn't bike friendly, for example, either. The city. So, can we give them some hope or some alternative encouragement?
Yep.
That there's something there for them to change over to.
Look, our intent was to put a big communication plan around that and remind them of the other choices. And look, we've got an opening tomorrow of the Western Rail Trail, which is a huge opportunity for people biking in the western suburbs to come to the CBD through biking. And we'll have some communication and promotion around that as well. So I think our intent was to communicate that. I take your point, it's not specifically in the consultation document, but it was going to be some broader communication around that. We were quite carefully considered that in the task force, and it's in the report that we didn't want to see this to be a substitute for promoting walking and biking, and that's that conflict in the strategy that Councillor Mallett raised. We still want to encourage what we call travel demand management and transport choice, so biking, public transport, just even the need for travel, but to sit alongside this, and we would communicate that, but it's not in the consultation document.
Okay, okay, thank you. That's me.
Any more? Thank you. Councillor Paula.
Thank you, Mayor Andrew. I've just got a couple of quite short questions, I hope. When will the remaining work of the task force group be completed? Because I actually supported a number of the points under paragraph 30. And when will that be completed?
Sorry, just looking.
On page 44, where it says the parking task force has identified some further matters. When will that be complete, that work, please?
Sorry, I was just looking at the terms of reference, but there is a mistake in that. So the terms of reference on page 52 said the final reporting back date was the 28th of March, but I didn't match up with the council resolution, which was in June sometime. So the intent was to report, June. To complete all the task force were meant to be time-bound, and I think if I went back to the resolution, it was the June meeting of council.
Yeah, so that would be in excellent timing to inform the any balancing in the long-term plan. It's dovetailed into our conversations for the long-term plan, right? Because we do start debating that.
It would dovetail into that, yes.
Okay, yep, thank you. Yeah. Can aspects of the technology be rolled out, keeping the meters in place for now and the booths that you pay at, such as the domes, for example, to better collect data and use that data to inform use, how we manage use and how we manage pricing? Could that happen?
Yep, absolutely. Rolling out the domes can be done as a separate portion, if you like. The big issue we have is geographic spread, so it would be sensible to roll out the domes now to the blue zone, because whatever we do, that was the intent. If you go with this proposal, it gives us more funding within the project to roll them out to the yellow zone. But we have been talking about that as staff. Like, we have, it is an approved project by council at the moment, and we are anticipating just starting with the domes and putting that out, because it's actually very good before and after data to have as well. So
yeah, absolutely. And I suppose if you need more domes, that's a separate question around funding. You can seek that additional funding without necessarily going to the rest of the proposal.
We'd probably roll the domes out in the blue zone to be safe, and then wait for this decision to know whether we got the funding to roll them out wider. Mm.
Okay. So I'm really interested in finding out more about how this will fix the following three issues. This is a question. How will this provide sufficient and appropriate parking for workers? Because we're all talking about parking place shuffle for workers, but of course workers in town are part of the revitalisation of the city, and we are actually trying to encourage more and more workers, people, professionals to come and work in our city, which is the right approach in my view. So that's one point. How will the working party work across the issue around appropriate parking for people who work in the CBD?
So part of the strategy is promotion of the alternative parking for workers. So there are parking buildings that are appropriate for workers, and a number of them in the CBD, north and south. So it would be promotion of those. Part of the Access Hamilton strategy, if you look on page 45, was coordination of parking services.
Mm-hmm.
And that was intended as almost a parking brokerage type system, where we got really close with all the parking providers in the CBD and shared information. So we, over time, we have started that collaboration, but we haven't taken that as far as we can.
I support that work. So that answers my question there. So there's still some more work to do around that. There's some more conversations to be had around it.
Yeah. For instance, part of the strategy that we never followed through was to promote on our electronic signs and where parking spaces were, to put non-HCC owned parking buildings. So we haven't followed through with that, but that's something we thought would be resurrecting.
Okay. So that's the next part of what I was going to ask about, is how can parking solutions work in with ensure better utilisation of the presently unused space, and that work is still in progress, right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's ongoing. Yeah.
Ongoing.
Yeah.
Also, I'm interested in how the parking solutions proposed work in with the free to users bus shuttle, the city shuttle. Because encouraging people to park in those outside zones would work better, presumably, if the shuttle was a direct interconnection with those areas where they're being asked to park. And I'm just wondering, what is there going to be any conversation or such around that?
So, just off the top of my head, I think the free shuttle still fits well with the strategy. Like, the intent of the free shuttle was to encourage workers to park in the buildings that were on the periphery of the CBD, and that was Knox Street in particular and the Monkton Trust building at the northern end of the city, then to be able to jump on a free CBD shuttle to get to their place of work.
Yeah,
so,
I'm familiar with the shuttle, but I'm just feeling more work should be done perhaps around integrating parking solutions with that city shuttle and finding out who exactly is using it the way it was intended to be used.
Yeah, so I'm aware, and you may be aware too, that through the regional council they're looking at the free CBD shuttle, so there was discussion around the development of the CCTP, and I think one of the actions in the CCTP is to investigate getting buses out of the CBD. So through the regional council and the regional passenger transport plan, there has been discussion started about whether we need the free shuttle or whether we could create a CBD zone that was any bus that came into the CBD was free. So you got a more variety of options free movement of people around from one end of the CBD to the other. So there is work in progress on that.
Yeah, fair call, but it's often more difficult to integrate work when you're doing it in a retrofit way, and I'm interested in integrating as we go. How does the proposal for parking support, I think it's been partly answered, how does it support other forms of transport, the multimodal journeys, the cycling, the walking, the busing, because we do have strong policy around that and strong plans around getting people out of the private vehicle and encouraging them to use other modes of transport as well, and potentially park and ride and all of those things. So how does the proposal, this proposal that we're considering today, not the broader proposal we might consider in the LTP, but this proposal, how does that support that?
Yep, so I think we've already talked about that today and the tension between travel demand management and economic development for the CBD. So the strategic framework we've got recognises both as important, and there will always be tension there. Our answer to that was to not leave behind travel demand management and public transport, but to promote that alongside this parking policy. And an obvious target for travel demand management is the worker population coming into there, as well as visitors to the CBD. So there is a tension there.
Which brings me back to my point about three different types of parking. You've got your workers parking, and let's accept that that's important because you know they do spend their money at lunchtime and coffee break time and all of the rest. There's that. There's people who want to come in for a sort of prolonged, reasonably high quality experience in the CBD, and we support that, whether that's events or whatever it is. And then there's the pop in and pop out people as well who want to pop in, come to their favourite place and pop out again. And I need some better information about how those things are being catered for within this proposal. I don't know if you can provide it now, but I'm just raising those as questions that I still have.
Look, the questions are noted. I probably can't add anything more than I've said already or in the report.
So your report, especially paragraph 47, was interesting to me because we all acknowledge there's an apparent desire and the perceptions around there not being sufficient parking, even though the data doesn't necessarily support there not being sufficient parking. And you're suggesting it would be good as a short-term strategy. So my question really is just, it's a little bit pointed, and I'm not going to apologise for that, but just put it out there. Is the recommendation that you have, that is in here, the preferred approach of staff, or was it a clear governance steer that that be the preferred approach? Because in the text I see that occasionally you're having a little bit of a bob each way.
It is taking direction from council.
Which is appropriate, but I'm just saying.
So my input to this debate has been to try and get council to focus on the strategy being around the 85% and to treat the pricing as a policy. And in my view, it's a policy that will probably be effective for a period of time, but you might get to a point in time where you're oversaturated and you're not achieving your strategy. So you need to have our eye on our strategy, which is about optimum utilisation of our existing street parking stock. So we are responding to the councillor direction, and the councillor direction is exactly the same one that was set out in the CCTP, and it was about a lot about perceptions of the CBD and the perceptions that parking was a problem, and particularly the lack of free parking was a problem. CCTP dealt with that in one way. This council is just looking, or through the task force, to deal with it in a different way.
I was just wondering about the relative weighting of governance versus staff, which is fine. Governance can have their opinion, of course they can.
Yeah.
The last question is sort of partly, people have danced around it a little bit, but it's a very complex issue, revitalising the CBD, isn't it? And we do not know to what extent this free parking will make the difference. And as it seems to me, and I think what I've heard in the various people that have spoken is that in some instances it's made a bit of difference, and in other instances it really hasn't.
Yeah.
So.
Look, I agree, and I think that was the answer that you got from me in terms of Hastings and what I read in their report, that there's so many factors that influence an uplift in a CBD or a downlift, and it's really hard to link the parking to it, and that's what Hastings couldn't do. I imagine in the Lower Hutt one it was really hard to, it could be a lot of other reasons why the CBD was declining and not parking, and so it was just hard to draw that link. Mm. So like the CCTP, this is to deal with perceptions in terms of encouraging people to come to the CBD. The tangible thing that we can monitor is the parking utilisation. I think sitting alongside that, we'd like to link through the monitoring pedestrian counts and other things as well, just to try and determine what's happening in the CBD. But drawing the link to parking would, I imagine, it would be just as difficult as Hastings found out.
Yeah, it's interesting that you say to fix perceptions, because I asked the question a couple of days ago when we had the work, the briefing, what outcomes is it going to fix? Perceptions is one thing, but what is it actually going to deliver is what I'm interested in. And I have heard some good debate today, so that's helped a little bit, but I'm still asking myself that question before I pose a cost on the ratepayer, absolutely for the technology, by the way. But I'm not sure you can answer that, but I'm raising it as a question because I think it's worthy of consideration.
Thank you, Councillor Paula. Councillor Mark.
Thank you. I just want to hone in a little bit on the rollout of the technology and what will happen if this doesn't pass today. So am I right to suggest or to believe that the domes will still go out in the blue zone? The kiosks is the issue for me, and I'm just wondering, are the kiosks a part of that existing rollout that's intended to go out?
Yes, so if this proposal didn't proceed today, it'd be my view that we're back to the status quo, which is the CCTP. I would prefer the opportunity, rather than just roll out the technology that we have developed to fit the CCTP, it would be good to be able to have an opportunity to bring that back to the parking task force to just reconfirm the technology solution we would wrap around the CCTP parking plan, which is free before 9 and after 3. So clearly, in my view, the parking sensors would be an important part of the rollout, but there may still be some options on kiosks that would be nice to be able to explore with councillors.
Okay. How much, Jason, I might ask you this one, how much are those kiosks?
Per unit, they're about $12,000.
$12,000 per unit. And how many are in the plan to bring?
30. Yep.
So how much is that?
$300,000.
$360,000. So if we weren't to get the kiosks, how many more domes could we buy for that? Or what area do you think we'd get within the same money without spending any more?
Yeah, we haven't done all of the exact figures, but we can certainly do the yellow area, the yellow zone, in terms of getting the domes out to that area as well.
Okay.
And plus there's all the signage requirements in terms of changing over signage reinstatement if we were to, and costs like that. So I'm comfortable that within the overall budget of $720,000, that we would, if we didn't roll out kiosks, that you could extend it to the yellow zone.
Extend it out to the yellow zone so you'd have the whole, essentially the whole CBD.
Correct.
And domes. Yep. Okay, cool. Thank you. Can you please elaborate? You've mentioned the number 85% quite a bit. Can you please just dig into that a little bit more and explain what that means?
So it's the average utilisation rate of the parking bay.
Right.
So 100% would mean that it's just full all the time.
Right.
So 85% of the means that 15% of the time that bay would be available.
Okay.
And the importance of that is you'll have visitors coming into the CBD. Hopefully they'll be guided by technology if they're technology savvy about where free bays are. But for people coming in and looking for a bay, if 100% of the bays were full at 100% utilisation, they'd be circling around the CBD, causing congestion and be getting frustrated because they couldn't reasonably find a park. So 85th percentile seems to be a metric that says to a person circulating the CBD there's a reasonable chance of finding a car park.
So it keeps it flowing and...
It keeps the congestion flowing and it keeps people believing there's a reasonable chance to park in the CBD.
Right, so at the moment with our map we've got big glutty areas of clogged parking and vacant areas not far away.
Yeah, so not surprisingly, you know, in the Barton streets and the high demand areas we've got high utilisation, particularly at peak times or certain times.
And yet in Harwood Street.
And other ones it's a lot less, because of the walking distance. A
couple of blocks away.
Yeah.
Rightio. Page 47, I just want to pick up on a point here. One of the technology and enforcement risks is that the adopted parking technology solution will not support the reintroduction of parking charges. And I'm just, how does that weigh up with the app that Wellington, Timaru, Tauranga and New Plymouth are all using, that one called Pay My Park? Now, I've been playing with that one, which is a really cool piece of technology and very easy to use. And it has payability on it, and yet they don't seem to have the kiosks in those areas.
I'd think about the comment. Sorry, what page was that on?
Page 47.
Page 47. I think the comment was targeted at people who are not technology savvy like yourself, and who would have a mobile phone and be prepared to use it.
Yep.
It's probably Martin, as Martin's described today, someone who just wouldn't want to use a phone and who wants to use coins or wants to use their swipe card or barter.
Or pay by chickens and things
like that. Yeah, so it was really tight. If everyone used a smartphone, and I think a lot of people in this room can see that future where everyone will use a smartphone, it would work. You wouldn't need kiosks because people would just use their mobile device to pay. That's why we said there is a halfway house where you get a good uptake of mobile phones, but also have some mobile phone technology in shops where Martin could go and use those.
Okay. So we could charge with just the domes, basically. There are ways of doing that, even if it is just by app. I just want to flush that one out.
Yeah, you do not need the kiosk, so you could have paid parking with everybody using a smartphone,
Okay. On the... Just I want to drill down on one of the questions that Councillor Leo asked there before. And so when the parking warden goes past and electronically chalks the car, They will be, am I right to see that they will actually be able to sell, so for example, if Leo had parked there 20 minutes ago, they would be able to see that he's been there for 20 minutes already?
Correct, that's my understanding. And so on their handheld, as they're approaching a bay, they'll be able to see that there is a car been in there for 20 cool. minutes.
Mm. And so this, so basically I won't know if I've been chalked or not, so I can't go along and rub the chalk off?
Correct.
Cool. Cool. Yeah. Great. So I can assume that I have been chalked?
You should assume that you are being chalked, yeah.
Outstanding. Cool, thank you. That's all I have.
Could I ask one question? Are the domes advanced enough so that as vehicles start coming out or people choose to put a system of identification on the car that they'll be able to read it? Are we up to that generation of dome yet?
Yep. Look, I know the answer to that's yes. I'm just talking to John.
Yep. So just making sure we're not putting in a type of dome that yep. may have to be replaced again in
yep. so
the near future.
Yep. So the domes, the technology's there already. It's just the accuracy of the technology, but the domes are compatible for what you're describing, yep.
And we're not right on the verge of next generation of dome being released? That we're just going to miss out on?
It's New Zealand technology, but it's world-leading. These guys are in the UK rolling out many, many domes. They're in the States and they're also in Australia. The ones that we're actually choosing here are the most advanced.
Great, thank you. Okay, are there any more questions before we go to debate? Sorry, Philip, yes?
One short question. Those sensors, or you call it domes, right? Is it run by battery?
Yes, it is, Philip, and the it's a 5-year cycle.
5-year cycle. Yes. So replacement is every 5 years you replace all the batteries.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Sorry. Thank you.
Okay, are there any more questions? Okay, so we have a mover and a seconder. So we'll go to debate. We'll start with Councillor Jeff as the mover. Thank you, Jeff.
I think it's fair to say the task force feels that we have a great opportunity to do something here. We've talked about perception. I talked about perception earlier, and I would think most of us probably would acknowledge that there is some sort of perception issue with parking in the CBD. And I think this is a great chance to change that perception dramatically. And send a very long overdue positive message. I would be first to acknowledge that it's not a panacea, Paula, and it's a complicated issue, parking in itself, as we can all see today, as is CBD revitalisation. And in fact, there's some really exciting things happening in our CBD anyway. There's some great building going on. We do see this as something the council can do, something very practical the council can do, a tool that we can put up to do our bit. And we do feel, well, I certainly feel that it's long overdue. And I apologise if I was a little strident with my introductory remarks. That's a misjudgment on my part. Put it down to too much passion, maybe, and too many cups of coffee this morning. I think one of the keys for me is the opportunity to protect those short-term on-street parks which service your retail and your hospo. And I don't think that's something that we've ever been able to successfully do without a prescriptive, inflexible and sometimes sort of punitive system. And I think the exciting thing for me is that with the new technology, I think we at last have the opportunity to do that. The key for me is that the use of this technology to stop that worker shuffle. We've talked about experiments of free parking in other cities, Rotorua, Hutt Valley, Nelson, which is still doing it, and one other, which I've just forgotten, but the the gist with them was they tried to do it with chalk, and they didn't entirely succeed. We have the opportunity to use a much more targeted system, and I think that may be something that's been lost a little bit in today's debate. The number plate recognition, the use of wardens with these sensors makes their job a lot more targeted and means that we can at last isolate and stop that worker shuffle. And I think that's more important than some of us realise here. We've tried to put some dollars beside the plan today to make it real, and there's always going to be discussions about public good and who should be paying, and I certainly accept that. And I look, if it goes out for public consultation, I look forward to some feedback on that from the community. We've tried to balance the benefits citywide and the benefits for business, but I remind you that it is a case of putting it out to public consultation. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get some feedback. I would urge you not to let this get bogged down in more discussions and the long-term plan and all that type of thing, because you're looking at a couple of years probably by the time you get through all that. We have an opportunity to send a really exciting message, and I urge you to take it. Thank you.
Councillor James.
Look, I'm in favour of the motion, and I want to thank the task force for the work that's gone on here. You know, I think King Solomon once said there was a time and place for everything, but he obviously didn't encounter the problem of trying to park his car in the CBD.
Not in Hamilton anyway, no.
But look, ultimately we're trying to lure more people into the CBD, and this is just one tactic to try and invigorate the city. Ultimately, the amount of money we're looking at here, and this is my opinion, is we're arguing over peanuts here. It works out at 50 cents a household per week. And if you use Vanessa's analogy that she used with coffee, that's, if you give up one coffee, you've paid for 2 months worth of, 4 weeks worth of your targeted rate. So, and we're looking at, it's around about $2.67, it works out a week for businesses, and that just makes them give up one cup of coffee a week, and they've paid for 2 weeks of their...
Where do you get coffee that cheap from?
Yeah.
2 weeks.
So, yeah. So, look, we do pay for a lot of things we don't use, and in answer to Councillor Martin's distortion analogy, look, I live within 80 metres of a bus stop, and I pay an extra $120 a year on my regional rates, and I don't use buses. And it's $120. We're arguing here over $26. So, look, this is a bit different, a lot different to the zoo plan we've put it out to the public. You know, at least with this one here, we have a funding plan for it, so we can actually show people what it's going to cost. If you put it into my lifestyle, then it'd be like me asking my wife if she wants to go to Gothenburg, and she says yes. The zoo plan, I said, well, that's nice, but I can't pay for it. But at least with this one here, well, I can say, do you want to go to Gothenburg? She says yes, and I says, well, good, I've got the funding here for it. So, look, we've got, it's a lot different to the zoo plan. We're putting out a plan to the public that we actually show there's a way of paying it and the way we're going forward, unlike the zoo one where we don't have any funding plan for it. So I'm in support of the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor James. Councillor Robb.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Look, I want to thank the task force. This is a very, very complex issue, city parking, and having sat on the CCTP in the last term, I know that much of our time was spent on the parking issue, both in terms of consultation as well as the discussions within the group. Look, the motion to collect a variable target rate from all ratepayers, in my mind, is illogical and it sets a bad precedent. It's a very siloed approach and does not consider other revenue streams that we've lost, And I think of the recent one in this council term, where we renegotiated a catering contract and we have lost a significant, or will lose a significant amount of revenue, and no discussion at all about how or where we would pick that revenue loss from. Mayor Andrew has previously signalled target rates for selected projects, and that we will discuss these during the long-term plan. I see some sense in ratepayers accepting target rates where visible outcomes are achieved, but I don't see any visible outcome being achieved by free parking. It's important also that elected members remember that rates are a tax, and this variable target rate is being applied indiscriminately with no regard to the value and the benefit to the city, to citywide ratepayers. There's also, as we found in the question time this morning, a lack of evidence that this will on its own work, and that this project will improve the vibrancy and increase the city spend. Councillor Taylor mentioned in his earlier questioning about parking meters and how these have become obsolete. My visit to Melbourne last weekend, I noted with some surprise that much of inner city Melbourne still has coin-operated parking meters. And that's a city that I think in this particular region we often look to as being one of the progressive cities. Councillor James also raised about the cost being 50 cents per household per week. Now, that's not strictly true, because some households will pay more than 50 cents with the variable target rate, and some will pay less. So this is this indiscriminate concern that I have. Taking this motion out for consultation essentially means this is the council's recommendation for the annual plan. It could be said that this is a bit of a knee-jerk reaction by some elected members to deliver their own election promises. I hope not. But I urge councillors to vote against the motion so that further work, as indicated in paragraph 30, and those unanswered questions from today could be considered before going out and seeking responses from city ratepayers. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Robb. Councillor Leo.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor Andrew. Look, this is a pretty emotional sort of an issue. There's really going to be no winners at the end of the day in this, to tell you the truth, because with parking, of course, everybody has a view. There's no two ways about that. What we're looking here, of course, is 2 hours free parking, which would cost our ratepayers almost 1.7. And of course, this has to come from somewhere. And to compensate for the loss of this revenue, CBD properties owners are going to have to front up with $139.05, and all our, on average, throughout the city, the ratepayers are going to come up with $26.57. And this morning, Vanessa Williams told us that only 47% of her members were actually in support of this. 47, didn't I say that?
You said
47%. Oh, 47. That's right, 47. Which is not a hell of a lot when you think that there's 900-odd, which the survey went out to. The other day I was listening to a local radio station, and there was two hosts on. One host was very supportive of the free parking within Hamilton, the proposal. The other host, of course, was totally against it. What it turned out to be is the one who was totally for it was not a Hamilton resident, and the one who was a Hamilton resident was totally opposed to it. So what we're really going to be doing is actually funding some sales rep from Auckland to come down to Hamilton and have free parking. When you look at parking, of course, the outer limits of the CBD all have free parking, and as you get closer into the CBD, of course, you come up with time limit parking, and then eventually, once within the CBD, you actually pay. 2 hours of free parking, I believe, will lead to traffic congestion, as the perception will be that it's free, and as a result, we will get people who will cruise the block in order to get a space in which to pop into. I really believe that the community accepts the fact that when you're in the CBD, you actually pay for your parking. and visiting other cities and that at times, I'm always very happy to actually find a spare park where I can pop into. Nobody in the community has ever mentioned to me that there should be any free parking within the CBD. What we're going to do here is to take $26 from the average householder. Some of these people, of course, don't even own a car. And for the gold card holders, of course, if they use the bus, of course, it's going to be free for them. And their chances of ever coming into town to look for a car park are very, very remote. I'm pretty sure Deputy Mayor remember the 1988 fiasco in which the late Sir Ross Jansen was the mayor at the time. What we actually did here in the city is removed all the parking meters, and then within a week, the same contractor came along and put them all back again. And that was a great money spinner for that particular contractor. And I know Sir Ross Jansen contacted me back in those days, and he says, "What the hell are we going to do about this fiasco?" And I said, "Put the meters back." And within a week, they were back. Everybody was happy again. I think that this is really, I see this as becoming another fluoride debate, which we had in 2013. You got a view on one side and a view on the other. And eventually, of course, there were no winners on that. I don't think the current system is broken at all. So why are we trying to fix something which is not broken? Let's for once apply a little bit of common sense, kick this proposal for touch, and give our ratepayers a rest from another surprise. To revitalise the city, it's not through free parking. The only way you're going to revitalise the city is to actually have people residing within the CBD.
Thank you, Councillor Leo. Councillor Paula.
Thank you, Mayor Andrew. Look, I'm not going to call this free parking because that's not what it is. It's subsidised parking, subsidised by the ratepayers, whether they visit the central city or not. Saying that, the parking task force have done a fabulous job, a great job, took over a very complex problem. So I want to thank Jeff and the rest of the group for your leadership and passion. And I actually applaud you, applaud your drive to act to address a long-standing issue. I do believe, I share the view, there is a perception of parking being difficult to find and a preference to have free parking. That's a given. You know, actually myself, I find it very frustrating having no coins in my purse when I need them the most. But of course, as I've said, the proposal's not free and it comes at a $26 a year rate to all ratepayers, and I think they'd be a bit surprised. I absolutely, though, support the rollout of technology, especially the domes, because I think that will be very, very useful in informing parking management and also the pricing of parking. So we must have that. New technologies are actually developing all the time and are looking very exciting. Mark Bunting showed me the Tauranga app yesterday and it looked, you know, it looked enticing and exciting. So if an amendment later occurs that covers off the technological aspects, I'd be able to support that part. However, I also want to say that I would have preferred to have seen the completed work of the task force before being pushed into making a decision partly informed on just one aspect. I'd like to see work done on park and ride options, as I've said, interconnecting with the free city shuttle better. I'd like to get to grips with CBD revitalisation in a much broader way. I've been consistent since I came on council about new proposals with costs attached to them being considered in the long-term plan so that ratepayers can understand the full scope of opportunities ahead of us along with the costs. So the ratepayer can have a say over priorities and what they're willing to pay for. For example, theatre, zoo, river plan, parks, parking. Where do their priorities sit? I'm being consistent with that view because I don't believe we should be ahead of the long-term plan picking winners. That process is not far away, a few months before the key discussions begin and not much longer after that before the public start to engage with the topics. this would actually allow the parking task force group to complete their work, and I'm really interested in the whole body of work. Let's do that work well, not rush it. Let's make decisions based on analysis, not on opinion, and not on political will. And then I really will be able to get behind this 100%. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Paula. Councillor Phillip.
Thank you, Mayor Andrew. Now, I think the parking in the CBD is an ongoing problem, and I do believe parking by itself is not the way to resolve the whole issues. There are many, many other things we can do, like build more apartments, move more people in, increase the number of population within the CBD, but parking is always the case. But when I look at parking in the CBD, we're not only looking for free parking or subsidized free parking. We also look at another matter. It's about convenience. So why people shop at the base? Because it's free, no time limit. But on the other hand, in the CBD here, people look at free parking plus convenience. If you look at the numbers, the occupancy rate, 70% and 35%, according to where you park in the CBD, that shows you people looking for parking, not only for free, they want convenience. I believe only until the day we can resolve these two issues, we can get the parking issues behind us. But in terms of just parking with time limit, 2 hours, I don't think it works. In my about 18 years of work in hospitality industry, in my own word, the two major types of shoppers. What in my word I say is target shopper. The shopper know what I want, where to go, just be there, half an hour done, go home. And that includes some people come out to CBD to meet a lawyer or accountant or do work in a bank or something, short time. These are the people, definitely they will benefit from this free parking, no doubt about it. But as well as the other shopper, what I call those leisure shopper, they like to come around, do the window shopping, have a little time spent around in the mall, go out to the a cafe with some friends here. And those are the people, they don't want to keep looking at the watches. How long have I been parking there? Because not everybody wants to park in the shopping mall, in the parking lot. So these are the two types. And for that one, I believe this plan, it will encourage those, what I call the target shopper or short-term one, but it might discourage the long-term or the leisure shopper, which they prefer to go to the base or Chartwell. They can spend as much time as they want, and besides, it's free. But among saying that, another thing is about the what mentioned previously about the variable target rate. And I believe, if we really have to do this, the target rate, we need to be fixed. And it needs to be very clear for what you're paying now is to subsidize the parking in CBD. That we need people to know, just like you pay $10 for the garden, you pay this $26, it's for you. You can come to the city and free parking for 2 hours. That's your benefit. We need to make it very, very clear. Now, I think I was one of the person pushing for the Hamilton Sioux plan on Tuesday to go out for public consultation. So this time I will support the motion. It's purely I want this to go out and let people know this is the plan. Tell us what you want. If most people come back and say, hey, we don't really want that, then it's the time for us. We need to look at should we go ahead or should we just drop it or look at other alternatives. So this is the main reason why I support this motion today. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Phillip. Councillor Dave.
Thanks very much. If this is the a knee-jerk reaction, as Rob described it, it must be the slowest twitch ever, because it's taken about 13 years for the message to get from here to my knee. This issue has been around for a long, long time. And one of the best things about the task force work, with a lot of really good support from staff and Jeff's leadership, and he's really agonised over this. He wakes up in the middle of the night thinking about it, from what I can see, looking at him in the morning anyway.
Are you next to him?
No, but I see him when he comes in. He looks terrible. A hell of a lot of work's gone into it. And, a lot of other people acknowledged it. That's good. But it's gone into it for a reason, because people could see a need, people have been crying out about a problem, And the task force basically said, well, let's see how quickly this problem can be addressed. They didn't say they were going to solve it overnight. They said, here's an idea that people have been calling for. We on the task force said, okay, how can we implement it? Now, there's several questions that need to be asked. Do you want free parking or not? If you want free parking, who should pay for it and when should it start? So the task force approached it, those questions to try and get some answers that it could put before the council. And I want to congratulate this task force, as opposed to some of the groups that came up with plans for Africa that we've had, including the other day, with no money attached to it. This task force was totally responsible and said, we don't want to go back to just to the council with a plan saying, yes, let's go for free parking, without saying where we're going to get $1.4 million to cover it from. We could do, as the last council said, and this is where I have to question the consistency of some returning councillors. Last council said, let's have free parking before 9 and after 3. The staff said, that's going to cost $800,000. And we didn't bat an eyelid about putting that into the general rate. No targeting, no transparency at all, just shoved into the general rate. And those councillors that are saying we shouldn't be putting a targeted rate on here for this need to think about why they supported that $800,000 for the partial free parking that the last council came up with. So I think you really need to be consistent. That argument doesn't wash for me. I mean, when we're talking about when it should start, now we could put it off quite easily. In fact, we're extremely good at this. Put it off until the LTP discussions. It'll get mixed up with a whole lot of other things and it'll stand or fall on its merits. But this is an issue that's been hanging around for a long time. We don't have to put it off until then. You know, do we want, my view is, do we want it this year or next century? Because that's probably how long it'll take to solve if we keep going the way we have for the last dozen years or so. I just want to talk about the rates. There's that question where we already charge, we're planning to charge in the general rates $800,000 to the ratepayers right across the board. Nothing to the bid, extra to the bid district, just to the ratepayers generally, across the board $800,000. That's one part. Another part of the rates, it probably talks to something Philip raised. He was asking why shouldn't it be a fixed charge, flat charge for everyone, rather than the variable charge that being a capital value rate will have. Well, the reason that the working party really came up with that in the end is because we linked it to the Access Hamilton transport rate that's currently in our minds, and we're proposing that it be linked here as well. That's how that rate's charged. That's how we charge for all other transport initiatives in the city. So it seemed logical and reasonable to charge in the same way. People have said, well, what about all the other transport modes we should be looking at? Well, I was one of the proponents. In fact, this council, I was probably the strongest proponent for putting on the free CBD buses. And we had to argue like hell with the regional council to get there, but on, and we had to put up an extra subsidy there to start with. And city ratepayers are now paying for that. And a lot of people and the city taxpayers are actually paying for the Super Gold Card, two things that have got people using buses more in the city. That was part of the strategy to get that happening. And but a lot of people said to us when we brought them in, they complained, you know, why should we have to pay extra for these extra buses when we never use the damn things, like James talked about earlier. Well, in this case, we are saying we're trying to address that issue by putting in some support for the people coming into the CBD with another transport mode. So I think...
Seconded. Thank you.
Thanks. I think that when we're talking about Access Hamilton, how this fits in, this is a part of the jigsaw puzzle that's been missing for quite a while, CBD parking issue. I've not been a long-term supporter of free CBD parking. I wondered whether it would work. But what I have seen is that nothing else we've done works. Nothing else works. And I think it's time to try this. It's not time to put it off for another year and a half or century and a half. It's time to actually get off our backsides and try it. And I see no logical reason why we can't start that now, except for if the public says to us, we don't like it, it's a terrible idea, and they say that in droves, then we should back off, because that's what you get from consultation. But if we don't put this idea out to them as a well-worked proposition now, we're never going to do it. Be realistic. Thanks.
Thank you, Councillor Dave. Councillor Angela.
Thank you. Through my time on council, we have had a number of trials of with elements of free parking, and after each trial, the businesses have always been consistent and come back and said, look, that didn't work for us, for a variety of reasons. Councillor McPherson made a comment about something else, that we've used other things and that it hasn't worked. As chair of the Transport Committee in 2011, I quote Councillor McPherson said, we have found the most convenient, a most important factor for shoppers is convenience. And there's no shortage of parking in the central city. Shoppers don't mind paying for parking if it is convenient. And that's where I have always supported every trial imaginable, and Councillor McPherson and I, we've been through all of this and we've trialled them all, but consistently I have it's been through those trials that I have realised, along with Councillor McPherson's comment in 2011, that actually it is about convenience, and that is about technology, and I am so there with you all if we can get to that point. It's about simple messaging, technology and convenience. Look, I think I'm actually going to go into bat here for the other working group, because I think, unfortunately, and I made it known when the Mayor proposed this motion through the annual plan, that it did supersede the working group, and I think that that was a real shame, and I spoke about that. I think that they have had to rush this, and haven't had the opportunity to really get in depth, and it's a big, as Councillor Taylor said, it's a big issue and it's a difficult issue, and I still want to maintain that that was actually the wrong thing to do at that time. And look, it isn't free parking, it's, let's call it what it is, it's ratepayer funded parking. Councillor Taylor, the chair of the group, has acknowledged it's not the magic panacea, and I also learnt the hard way when I came on council thinking, oh, free parking, that's it, that's what we'll do, and it hasn't worked to date. And let's be honest here, the main motivation for this is that it will be another tool, and that will be a magic pill that will help reinvent and reinvigorate the central city. And that's in spite of the evidence from all of our trials, the feedback that we have had from the businesses, and the evidence from another city that I found last night who took economic data that proved that it delivered no economic benefit. They're stopping their free parking and going back to charge. And look, the economics are really simple here. When we provide a goods or a service, someone has to pay. Councillor Casson and Taylor commented that they had a, you know, it's great that this proposal's up here because we have a funding plan. Yes, you have. Your funding plan is the ratepayer. This proposal will cost ratepayers $14 million over 10 years. We're moving from a very fair user pay system to a ratepayer funded system. And I absolutely acknowledge the passion behind the working group and the single-minded focus on the issue at hand, but at this point in time, for those reasons that I've laid out and for the evidence that certainly I have come across and been involved in my 9 years on council with this really difficult issue, I cannot support the current proposal. But I absolutely want, if this fails, want the ability for that task force to get round the table again and to have another look at this and hopefully do something really great for the future of the CBD parking, talking about convenience and technology.
Thank you, Councillor Angela. Councillor Mark.
Hi, right. Leo, thank you for acknowledging radio hosts. And if you're going to base your decision on radio hosts, let me sway that by saying that this radio host is for it.
That's 2-1.
And I live here. That's 2-1. Yeah. Okay. Okay, slightly out of date and not very good radio host anymore, but by the by. Listen, we were asked by the ratepayers, the CBD, the CCTP and this chamber to do something, and so we did. We did something. And all I've heard, contrary to what Leo's heard, is I shop at the base because it's free to park there. I shop at Chartwell because it's free to park there. Now, I acknowledge that we also represent the base and Chartwell, so they are not the enemy in this. All I hear is that the parking wardens are really mean people. There is a perception around the CBD, and perception is reality. And what shocked me when we started on this task force, sorry, I'm going to sit down and look like Yul Milson. What shocked me when we started this, this was from the income we derived. In rough figures, we bring in $4 million from parking over. $1 million is from people paying their meters. $1 million is from parking off-street and paying that into council facilities. And get this, $2 million, over $2 million, from fines and penalties. This system is based on over half our income being derived from people not following the system, by people getting it wrong. And we wonder why we have a perception problem. The current system is flawed, and it won't come right unless we treat parking as a service and treat Hamiltonians with respect. It is broken. What's proposed is a far more user-friendly, easy to comply with convenience system where parking is valued rather than resented. Listen, I've been asked many, many, many questions. Here are the very quick 10 FAQs, which are frequently asked questions, okay? Question number one, I never go into town, so why should I pay for it? The answer is, well, maybe now you are paying for it. You will go into town. We want you to, come on in. 2 hours free parking. You've only got to come in and spend 1 hour per month for this to work, and you're winning out of this. 1 hour per month, and you're winning. Question number two. I never go into town, so why should I contribute through my rates? Well, I go to Waterworld once a year. I haven't swung on one swing in a destination playground. There are lots of roads I don't drive on, and I haven't yet used the crematorium, but I do pay for them because it's a reasonable expectation of living in a community. Question number three, Bunty, you opposed the Bazoo plan going out to public consultations. Why are you so supportive of this? The answer is because it has a suggestion of how it could be paid for. So the public can make up their mind, knowing up front that this is how it could be paid for. All we're doing is asking for putting it out for consultation. This will not end up, in my mind, to where all the others have and will on that great coffee table in the sky, buried underneath each other. Question number four, why are the CBD getting special treatment? Here's the answer. I challenge anybody who supports the river plan, the development of the museum, Victoria on the River, the ferry bank, the central library, and potentially a regional theatre to provide a better solution, or even a solution at all. The CBD is more than just a shopping experience now. We have a massive investment in this part of town. And in case you haven't noticed, there's a couple of reasonably successful retail complexes just further north. It is more than just a shopping experience, the CBD, and if we want this to work, we've got to put the money where the mouth is. Question five, what about the workers? Where are they going to park? Let me think. Downtown car park, Knox Street car park, their own buildings car park, a few blocks to the east, to the north. These are the people for whom we've supplied the orbiter, the shuttle, buses, a user-friendly cycle network for. They could carpool. Get ready for Uber, ladies and gentlemen, and driverless cars. Beep, beep, they're on the way. Heaven knows I'm about to start commuting that way myself. This proposal is designed to make the heart of our wonderful city accessible again to customers and uses our wonderful facilities to keep those arteries of that heart clear and keep things flowing to 85%. Question six. I can still park for free at the base in Chartwell. Not forsaking that. You can actually pay through that parking through your shopping. But we need to recognise that the central city's car parks are more than just that. They are also roads. They pose a particularly different dynamic, and we need to provide spaces to keep us parked and to keep us moving as well. Question seven, we've tried this stuff before. Oh, yes, we have, and this may not be the final outcome, but it is streets ahead of anything I've seen done before. This is a game changer because it comes with parking technology that opens the door for much more functionality. We'll be able to monitor real time where the parks are, how the flow is, where the problems might occur. Apps may come, apps that direct you into businesses, apps that tell you what movies are on. Thank you. Where the specials are, what's on display at the museum today, what the weather's going to do while you're in town, apps that might even tell you when the library's going to reopen. Don't
put the don't put the technology in, and we're left without that technology. We're left with parking meters, and yes, they may have them in Melbourne, but these parking meters, our parking wardens take home and fix in their own garages. They're that old. Question eight, what if we don't have smartphones? Think about the oldies. The answer is, I'd suggest for everybody who might not have a phone these days, there are a hell of a lot more people that don't have coins. Personally, I only keep coins for parking and for gold coin donations, and sadly, they all get robbed by my children before I get to the car. I can't remember where I paid for anything other than parking using coins. The future ain't what it used to be. Don't be afraid of this technology. We have all got it in our pocket. If we want a city that attracts people into the future, we've got to meet them there. People are using phones, not coins. Finally, and very quickly, it's not free parking at all. It's a ratepayer-funded parking scheme. Yes, it is. But unlike any other tax or rates that disappear into a black council pit, this is a transparent levy for a service that you're highly likely to use more than you pay for. And if you don't use it yourself, you still benefit from a thriving central city. And finally, question 10, what about warrants and regos? Any alteration of that policy is not on the table. We want compliant, safe cars on the road, and that is to continue. So make no mistake, the city is not going to suddenly start thriving when we put a free parking sign up, but it is a part of the solution. It may not be the perfect solution, but it is a giant step on the way. So let's make some tweaks on the way to that destination. Stay on course, councillors. Send this out to consultation.
Thank you, Councillor Mark. Deputy Mayor Martin.
Yes, thank you. I must find out what radio station you are on. I listen to the national radio. That's quite good, actually. Very good. Very interesting commentary. I do fully agree. I think, actually, Councillor Bunting sums it up. So he's. I'm going to try and be short because he said everything far more eloquently. And I think his key message is we must not forget, and let's be transparent and remind the ratepayers they do subsidise the base and Chartwell and Dinsdale. Of course they do, in terms of the roading infrastructure and the orbiter bus and all of that. So this reality is that the ratepayers are only having to pay for the CBD actually is a myth and is a misnomer. What we want, and the motive which is good, is we want a fair level playing field so that the businesses of the CBD have a fair shake to get customers along with those businesses in the other parts of town as well. I do stress that it seems that this is going out for consultation. That's what we're being asked. It's also an honest and good consultation because it's actually being up front with the people of this city, because with any plan, there is a price tag. So it says the price tag, suggested price tag, and how's that to be funded. One of the things I think we should do, and I am a strong supporter of the Julie Hardacre Council's CBD transformation plan. And I'm a strong supporter of Julie Hardacre, former mayor and this mayor, wanting to rejuvenate with the rest of us our CBD. And I think Councillor Bunting gave the tapestry of all the other things that are actually on the go in the CBD that hopefully will make it a vital CBD. And I just want to say to the Parking Task Force, it's really important that we don't soft pedal on all of those other initiatives. And, you know, if you look at two sections of Victoria Street, it's not just free parking that's going to sort of turn it around. And you look at the Victoria Street South, which is the entertainment precinct, and you look at the beautiful vegetation, the Sappermore Jones statue, and the angle parking, it's inviting, right? And I know that's an entertainment, not necessarily retail there. You go to the part of Victoria Street, which I did the other day, south of Bryce Street, and the scene is very different. You know, very low pedestrian count. Some people sitting on the pavement waiting for me to talk to me down the track and want money and all of that stuff. So I think there's a combo of compassionate central city safety people, police, all of that. You know, people have got to feel comfortable when they come into shop. You know, in other words, the shopping experience has got to be good. The only and finally fish hook I would raise, and I would ask the Parking Task Force to keep and staff to keep monitoring this, is I do have a slight worry when people come into the CBD, and I'm just a little bit worried about the 2-hour time span over every given day.
And I do give the example of someone comes at 9:30 in the morning, goes and sees a lawyer, accountant, does a bit of shopping, and then people want to come back into the CBD later in the afternoon to chill out and then go off to a show and have a meal. And I just want to make sure that when you roll, if people through the consultation agree with this new process, that we do, could I say in terms of enforcement, we allow a bit of flexibility and perhaps for the first month or two we do monitor some of those trends. I don't want to see another Dinsdale Road. And you know what happened there, where we tried to promote the 40k speed limit, and for some inexplicable, because Leo wasn't around then, obviously he wouldn't have done it, but for some inexplicable reason, you know, you have a speed enforcement and we issue a whole lot of tickets rather than people just monitoring what were the trends at the time, and you immediately kill the goodwill to a new proposal. So I do would ask Councillor Taylor and Chris and the team, could you just look at if this is finally implemented, that we do look at some transition phase and you do closely monitor some of those trends so that you don't have the opposite effect of discouraging shoppers and business in town. With regard to the technology, Councillor Bunting again is right. Frankly, another 10 years, there will be no discussion around technology. Of course, older people, a whole range of people will have adapted fully. And I do acknowledge that things are rapidly changing. But congratulations, Councillor Taylor and your team and staff for at least trying to do something positive for our CBD and its vitality.
Thank you so much, Mayor Andrew. Well, how can I follow all these eloquent speakers and flamboyant ones to boot with that? That was fantastic. Well, thank you to the task force. That was very, what can I say, you've put a lot of work in. And I'm for years I was pro free parking in the city, coming with three little children quite often into the city. But of course that was before BASE and Chartwell was just too far away from Dinsdale. I was just amazed to hear about the fines, and I don't think they will change because people will still stay longer, and even because it is confusing with the new technology, although I'm excited about the new technology because I never had the coins in my pocket either. So that's going to be exciting about that. I'm still not a bit 100% sure, like Councillor Kesson said about taking his wife to Gothenburg, and you know he can pay for it with this plan. But you know, I would love to go to some other restaurants too sometimes, and you know that would be a great plan to have money for that as well. So what I would just like to see is great to put it out to the people to ask them and get their opinion on that. But I also want them to know that, yes, we've also got other plans, and they need to, if they want them, they need to be paid for as well. And this is just one. So do you want Gothenburg, or do you want Victoria, or do you want the bank, or where would you like to go? I think that's the big question. We have to give people that chance to have more choices. Because when I think about, I much rather pay the $2 or whatever it costs for 2 hours in town, and but have the zoo subsidized, for example. That's just my person. So, but not knowing that, and just agreeing to, oh yeah, I would love free parking, but in the end, then the zoo's gonna get, you know, that's not gonna happen. So it's just thinking about. And I get that we want to do something for the city, and I know 30 years ago it was an exciting city. I mean, there was things happening in the city, but is that the only thing? So I'm looking forward to close monitor. Well, first of all, to have it out there for consultation, and then if it goes through, to really close monitoring whether it makes any difference, and if not, then go back again. And Councillor Tuman said, in most cities you're expected to pay in the CBD. And but that I'm sure we have to also look at the CBD as what do we really want for it? What's really the goal for the future? Do we want to have it like Utrecht? a fairly car-free city where there's lots of biking happening, and their weather is much worse than Hamilton weather. So, that's sort of more my thinking. But in the meantime, I'm looking forward to what the people have got to say in Hamilton. Thank you.
Okay, before we go back to Jeff, I'll just say thank you to the staff who worked on this. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you, John, particularly. Thank you, Jason, Chris, Vanessa, for her input. That was great. And also thank you for the task force. I think they were very enthusiastic. They did their homework. They researched widely what was happening in other cities around New Zealand and partly even outside of New Zealand, and just for their vision for a better CBD. So thank you. Back to you, Jeff.
I would also like to very much thank the staff for all the work that they've put in. It's been a huge effort and I really appreciate it. Thank you. And councillors, thank you for your comments. I've appreciated some of the considered thoughts that you've put up, and some of you make some good points. Councillor Robb, you're right. There is a lack of evidence that will work, but that's because it's pretty new. It is technology that hasn't, to this extent, been used in New Zealand, and so yeah, there's no getting away from that. It is new, but I also think it's exciting. One of the points we have in our recommendations is that the task force will monitor. If this goes through, the task force will monitor what's going on. And the other aspect is this technology provides a huge amount of information on parking occupancy real time for staff, which we've never had access to before. You know, so that's going to stand us in good stead. I was a little bit alarmed at your comment about a knee-jerk reaction. I don't feel that way. I like Councillor McPherson, I think this has been around a long, long time out in the community. Leo, you mentioned that I think that you questioned the validity of the results from the CBD Association's survey. It is a small sample, no doubt. But I think it was 47% of those that responded supported it. And I would put it to you that human nature being as it is, if you ask a group of people if they want to pay an extra $150 a year for something, no matter what it is, if the majority still come out in favour, I think you're doing pretty well. You mentioned that no one, and very seldom in the community do you have people talking to you about free parking. Well, you must have knocked on different doors than I did during the election campaign, because of the few thousand that I did, a good portion of them talked my ear off as soon as the issue of parking in town came up. Councillor Angela, I appreciate your experience and what you're saying about what's happened in the past. Totally understand. There's been trials in the past. You mentioned some of the results from other cities in New Zealand. I do question, again, how much stock we place in some of those, because I do think we're at the vanguard of some new technology, whereas some of those cities are still at the stage of chalking tyres. And if we, I just think if we can get past that issue of, which is the first thing anyone ever said to me, you can't do that because the workers will steal the parks. If we can find some way to make that work, then I think we're onto a fantastic thing. Councillor Paula, totally appreciate what you're saying. It does come at a cost, parking. I don't think it ever was going to be anything but that. There was going to be a loss of revenue. It does come at a cost. All we're saying is let's go out and ask the people and say, hey, 2 hours free parking, what do you think? This is what it's going to cost. Is it worth it to you or is it not? And just to sum up on that point, I think we have a choice here. Move forward, have the opportunity to remove every one of those parking meters that keep me awake at night from the CBD at long last, implement a state-of-art suite of technology and a positive message. Do we do that, or do we just sit on it and talk about it for another couple of years? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor Jeff. So we'll go to the board on this one, please.
The motion is carried, 8-4, 4 against.
Okay, thank you. We'll break for lunch. We'll be back at 2 o'clock to start. Thank you.